And the next talk that we have is from Shashank Srinivasan. He's the founder and the director of technology for wildlife, with the mission of helping organizations amplify their conservation impact through the appropriate use of modern technology. Shashank specializes in the use of geospatial data and robotic systems, and more recently was the coordinator for GIS and spatial analysis with WWF India in Delhi. He's here to talk about how OSM data can be used for biodiversity conservation.
I'll begin now. So I've been told I have 20 minutes. It's 11:24 right now, so I'll try and wrap up by 11:55. So just to give you a quick brief, my name is Shashank. I run a small organization based out of Panjim in Goa, which is called Technology for Wildlife. In this talk, I'm going to tell you a little about the work I do, what I'm using spatial data for in my work itself, what kind of conservation work I do. And towards the end of the talk, I'll be talking about how I actually use OSM data itself in my work, all right? So again, I won't stop for questions during the talks. If you have questions, I'll definitely make sure I have at least 5 to 10 minutes at the end of my talk itself. So to begin, why is geospatial data essential for wildlife and environmental conservation? So this is important to understand. You know, it's not just about like studying individual animals, but why do we need to look at like geospatial data itself, looking at larger areas? And like there are multiple reasons, but again, for this talk, what I'm focusing on is the fact that conservation is a human land use decision, all right? So when we choose to say we're going to conserve particular areas for wildlife conservation, for environmental conservation, these are land use decisions. And again, they are intensely political decisions because different people, different communities have different reasons to use land in a particular way. Again, in India currently, the discourse is about the urban elite saving tigers while the locals don't want them, and it's far more complex than that, all right? There are nuances which need to be understood when doing conservation, and again, like it all comes down to land ownership and control of land at the end of the day, which is why geospatial data is crucial to actually do conservation efficiently and as ethically as possible as well. So again, to go back to the work I do, I run Technology for Wildlife. The mission for this organization is that I amplify conservation impact, okay, through the appropriate use of modern technology. What this means is that I work directly with partners, clients, collaborators. I have very few projects of my own which I'm running independently. So I find people who are doing conservation work who can use the services I have to offer and then work with them to actually make their work more efficient, to amplify their impact as it were. I use appropriate, and that's a very key word in this context, because again, I'm not a technology evangelist. So I'm not going in and saying, okay, this is technology, you have to use it because it is the best out there. It's a very clear process of assessing what technology is best for a particular purpose and then seeing whether it's going to be useful, whether it's going to be impactful or not, and proceeding from that point onwards. I specialize in geospatial data and robot operations. We're building capacity in AI, augmented virtual reality work as well, but a lot of the work I'm doing in that area is outside of regular conservation itself. So for conservation, I'm focusing on these two areas. The clients I'm working with currently, I have large NGOs, there are people working in infrastructure, there are government departments who are, I provide services to directly. I'm partnering a lot with small conservation NGOs and enterprises, right? So all the projects I have are either on a service model or a collaboration model. The kind of services themselves, so there's conservation planning, right? So helping people actually look at large areas of land, figuring out which plots of those lands need to be set aside based on biodiversity assessments, which is also a part of the services I do, which is looking at a lot of data for a particular area, figuring out how to integrate it with, again, multiple data sets, and then saying, okay, fine, this is a risk to biodiversity, these are the areas you need to conserve to ensure that wildlife, the environment is left pristine. Spatial analysis, which is a component, again, which feeds into what I mentioned earlier. So you actually look at data, analyze it, get some insight out of it. Print and web cartography, which is communication, marketing, outreach, essentially. So you've made a decision, you know which plots of land you want to conserve, you know what the local community you're working with should be doing, and how do you actually communicate that to them. And finally, what I'm doing a lot of more recently is aerial imagery acquisition and processing. Okay, so I'm using a lot of drones, using some imagery from planes as well. And I'll be talking a little more about that in this talk. So this is a general conservation GIS work I do to get a sense of what is conservation GIS, right? Like why would, again, I explained why we need geospatial data, GIS for conservation itself, but what does it actually mean? For example, this is a golf course somewhere in Gurgaon, okay, and this was a client who essentially were doing a biodiversity assessment of their golf course, right, which is not really a very friendly system for wildlife. But they had done a number of bird surveys, and they had data over here which is essentially of different bird species and where they'd seen them. So this is the most basic level. Someone wants a report, they need to know, okay, how diverse is the bird life on this plot of land they control, and then, okay, just map it out, okay? So it's basic data going onto a map. Slightly more complex stuff, where you can create web-based tools which actually integrate spatial data to help with people, to make people, they can make better decisions, essentially. So for example, these are representative of wildlife areas of planned telecom towers being set up in a particular landscape, and then looking at, okay, how do you actually assess each tower? How do you get people to actually understand the data better? And this one is, again, using a couple of web scraping tools to actually pull data out on elephants which have been killed due to railway accidents, right, which is a pretty topical issue in India right now. So this is a web-based map which actually, if you click on each point, it will give you like a small brief of an incident, and then it will give you like the web link to the news story where the incident occurred, right? So you can actually go and get more information, and it lets you also do stuff like hotspot analysis, other kinds of spatial analysis on the data itself, right? So this is again ways of creating conservation data to feed into other tools. Talking about the aerial imagery, which is again very highly localized work. Essentially, I'm collecting images using drones, right? So I fly drones, collect images which I can then use for various purposes. So that's like the basic level. What you can do with the UAV is fly it up, take photographs. So this is all bits of Goa which have been done for different clients, right? And again, the projects aren't like, okay, give me three photographs. They're like, okay, help me make a map of a particular area. And how that's done is you take multiple photographs. So for example, over here I've got like a grid of a 4x5, that's 20 images. Normally a mapping project would be at least 200 images, okay? So these are 200 images which you're collecting, which are, again, you're programming your device to fly in a particular pattern, take images at particular intervals. Lots of like technical issues around like, okay, what kind of processing are you going to do on the imagery itself? Anyway, but the idea is you're collecting images with a flying robot. You can then stitch the images together to actually create a georeferenced map, right? So this is like satellite imagery, like again, what you see on Google Earth, but this particular image has a resolution of about 1 centimeter GSD, which is, you know, like it's 1 centimeter per pixel. So I can look at individual bits of plastic, for example, in the garbage dump on the left, and I can count, okay, how many bags of garbage have they got over there over a period of time, right? Another kind of thing you can do with aerial imagery. The other thing you can do with aerial imagery is analyze the image itself the way you would analyze satellite imagery. For example, over here, this is a section of Mahadevi Wildlife Sanctuary in eastern Goa. And this is again numerous images taken and stitched together for a very small area. This is about maybe about the three acre plot of land, all right? And you've got this image, which is useful in a sense of georeference. You can count how many trees you have on the plot, for example. But you can also run remote sensing techniques on the bands itself to actually look at, for example, vegetation, right? So this is something called synthetic NDVI, which uses the red and green bands, and you can run a formula on them to actually look at chlorophyll density across the landscape. But let's say look at vegetation health, right? So I can see where there's, you know, no vegetation is the red patches, and then the greener it is, the more chlorophyll it's got. So the more leaves, the, you know, just the denser the quality of vegetation, essentially. You can also use this kind of data for vegetation health mapping. So you can actually see in a plot of land, which is maybe like a plot of rice, for example, which areas of the crop are stressed, right? So those are the non-conservation agricultural applications of like using drone imagery, remote sensing. You can also do before after comparisons, you know, so you've got, for example, over here I've got a patch of mangroves on the 7th of May of this year, which a week later had been chopped down to make way for agriculture, right? So you can clearly see the route the JCBs took to actually do the cutting and the destruction of the mangroves. In this case, you're using this kind of work to actually work with local communities to convince them that they should be leaving mangroves which are along the edges of the banks intact. They don't need that for agriculture, right? So you can actually show them, okay, leave these mangroves. If you have to cut them down because it's your land, you control the land, you want to do this, cut it down here. But leave that because there is wildlife which depends on it. So in this particular area, there are otters which have been seen, you know, in this habitat. And again, it's important to be able to have this kind of meaning to show people which areas they should be setting aside for conservation. Finally, I won't dwell too much on this, but it is possible to also create 3D models out of this imagery, right? Which you can then used to do volumetric calculations or even create, again, augmented reality, virtual reality experiences of a particular landscape. So this is all applications of geospatial data from UAVs. You can also integrate the data again with satellite imagery, with OSM data, and you can create multi-layer maps, which are quite powerful. So I want to show a video of the final bit of work which is not relating to spatial data, but again, like some of the work I do with drones itself. So this is the project I undertook last year for the UP Forest Department and the World Wildlife Fund, where they had a, again, I'm not sure, can I have the lights off if you don't mind? Is that possible? Well, quite briefly, this is a project where they wanted an overwatch of a tiger capture operation, all right? So they had a marine tiger loose that had killed two people in the previous week, and the day after we got there, they killed another person that morning, all right? So the forest guards, the forest department itself did an operation where they actually went, tracked the tiger, found the patch of land it was in. And then after that, we were providing continuous surveillance of that patch of land to monitor what was happening. So essentially, it was a command and coordination operation where the drone team itself, which I was part of, we had walkie-talkies, which were communicating with the people who ran the actual operation itself, who in turn were communicating with people on elephant back. All right, so that was the process in terms of how the communication was working. In this video, you can see the elephants over here. So there's no sound for this video. But you can see the elephants suddenly here and charge into the sugarcane patch. And you can see the tiger coming out over here. So the slower close-up version as well. So the elephants charge in, the grass starts moving there, and the tiger comes out over here. Right? So this kind of utility for like having an aerial device is quite powerful, because at this point of time, what had happened was that the people on elephant back had used a tranquilizer gun to shoot the tiger. And it came running out of the other side. And they couldn't see it because they were an elephant back. So they were not able to see the tiger itself because the sugarcane blocked them. But we could tell them the tiger is now out of the patch and it's moved to the other side. So they could then shift the focus of operation from the central patch to the one of the side patch of the sugarcane, right? So that's the kind of thing you can do, again, with drones, which is not exactly spatial mapping, but is extremely powerful for conservation anyway. Finally, the focus of the, again, what my talk was titled, but I figured I would talk more about general conservation GIS itself, is how I use OSM for conservation, right? And I use OSM for conservation a lot. It's one of the crucial layers for my work because I do find it the best available data set, especially in rural parts of India and Southeast Asia. So first, this is something I made quite recently. So the drone regulations are out, which basically inform everyone where they can and cannot fly drones, all right? So I've used OpenStreetMap data to actually map out these areas. So for example, the regulations have information like you cannot fly a drone within 3 kilometers of a military base. You cannot fly it within 5 kilometers of airports in the big metros and 3 kilometers of airports in small metros, right? So there are a bunch of rules which you can codify and then run in GIS itself. So in this case, you can see that for India, the rule is from the national border, you can't fly within 25 kilometers of the national border, right? Which is why that purple line around the outer border. You cannot fly above national parks or protected areas. So in this case, you can see again a zoom up of the Goa, Maharashtra, Karnataka area. The next map shows that these are national parks, okay, which I have outlined them in green. So the idea is that you can use OpenStreetMap data to actually look at policy which impacts conservation even tangentially, which is okay. Now drones cannot fly in these areas because they are designated national parks. How does that apply to areas which are buffer areas? So can you now use these to inform drone regulations to expand to cover other areas which need to be covered, essentially? Right? Don't fly in areas which elephants are walking through, for example. Right? So that's the kind of stuff you can use OSM data for. You can use it to create maps like this, which are a map of India's roadless areas. So roadless areas are areas which are not close to essentially large roads. So this indicates fragmentation across the country. And the main highway data layer I've used here is OpenStreetMap National Highway for India itself, right? Which shows you how fragmented India is in terms of just areas which are not close to roads. A close-up version of the Northeast. The same thing, the light green is areas which are 1 kilometer near a national highway. The green is areas which are 10 kilometers further away. Right? So this map changes quite rapidly year on year as the highway network increases. And we really are losing roadless areas in India. I'm going to show you my last quick project, which is the focus of, again, I use a lot of OSM for this as well. This is a very rough map, which the all the lines within the India border are, again, the national highway and state highway network. The red polygons are tiger habitat, and the blue polygons are elephant habitat. All right. So this kind of data, again, I can integrate multiple data layers to do analysis. So using these four layers and a couple of other layers as well, I could create this map, which is biodiversity adjacent to India's highways, right? So doing a bunch of geoprocessing clipping operations, finding areas of biodiversity near highways itself, and then identifying, okay, which ones are tiger, elephant, protected areas, bird areas, and so on. And then use again, zoom up, you can use that to look at what factors are most important near particular highways. You can create risk maps, which are essentially, okay, which, you know, if people are investing in these highways, then which, how many factors are they likely to actually intersect with, how problematic are a particular section of highways going to be. And finally, you can use the same things to make a web tools, right? So I can actually make an interactive map so people can zoom around. And again, all the highway data here is from OSM. Right, so as I was talking to Naveen about yesterday, who did the Wikimedia maps talk, I personally have found national park protected area highway data extremely valuable. I use only OSM because no other data set in this context compares anyway. And if I find errors, I can correct them automatically, have other people, you know, correct them for me. If I can send out an email saying, can you please fix these three NPs in the Northeast, and I can then use the data to do a project, right? So that's essentially how I use OSM data to do my conservation GIS work. Yeah, any questions, please?
Hi, I think we had a discussion yesterday as well during one of the sessions. I think it was Naveen's session when we were talking about the national parks. Mm-hmm. So can you elaborate what is the source of these maps? Because I don't know if they're available openly, and if it's not, what's the license to be sharing them?
Okay, so the national park data itself is from OSM in this particular case. All right, but the other main data set for national parks is something called the Protected Planet, which is run by UNEP WCMC out of the UK. That data set doesn't compare to the quality of this one. So again, for these data sets, I have it's OpenStreetMap license for the map, for the map data, for the national park data.
Just to ask further, is that data that's available on OpenStreetMap, is it like similar to what the government would have in terms of the buffer maps and the maps for all tiger reserves?
No, it is only the it is only the outline of the tiger reserves itself. Okay, so for example, the government data, what you can get from the government would be, again, from the forest department directly, and that they will not share for public use, is details on buffer zones on reserve forests as well. What's on OSM matches perfectly with the core area of the tiger reserve itself.
So that actually brings me to the final part of the question, is that given that this data, for example, is not validated by any government right now, what is the process to make these the maps that you've made in terms of risk assessment and proximity to the road for tigers or elephants, what is the process next to make it something that is accepted officially? Like, what is the part to go there?
Right. So, okay, that's a really interesting question, because I personally have found that to be a losing game in terms of trying to get getting the data in the first place is hard enough. So for me, I'm trying to see, okay, what is the most accurate picture I can paint of the map. There have been cases where I've done exactly what you said, and then I've been told, okay, use Forest Survey of India data. But the data is really bad compared to OSM data, essentially, right? So I would prefer to use OSM data and then make the argument of, and then do the data comparison argument separately, which is, I can show you these two data sets and you can qualitatively be shown that one data set is better than the other in terms of how it's matching up with, say, satellite imagery. Right? And that's the way I've taken so far anyway. But making it official, I'm not even going to try to make the data sets themselves be officially accepted. My thing is to make these maps and this information which I've communicated officially accepted. Yeah. How much time do we have for questions? Okay.
Hello, sir. It was a very nice presentation. Who is the end user of the maps which you are using, if you're doing?
So a lot of the work I've, again, I'm not talking about specific clients right now, but I've done, So that's the way I'm breaking it up.
Yes, large NGOs, infrastructure companies, okay, fine. And you have also mentioned about tiger habitats, elephant habitats, all those things. So what security are giving for the wildlife through these maps? Because the end user might be using this particular map for some poaching activities or some illegal activities.
So I'm very good. Yeah. So wildlife security, especially from a data perspective, is extremely important, right? So again, none of these maps use radio collar data, for example. Okay. None of them are actually going to be identifying the individual animal itself to a location within, like, you know, like 500 meters, for example. It's identifying ranges of animals, which is that, okay, in the past 10 years, based on scientific information, the tigers have been known to inhabit this particular area.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Hi. So as you are avid user of drones, right, UAVs, so what are your thoughts? What do you think about keeping drone imageries in open source?
So I think open aerial map, open drone map are quite powerful. I've been talking to some of the hot OSM people over here as well, and I think it's been difficult to find the funding or to actually get it implementation up and running. But to answer the question briefly, I think it's a great idea, especially for post-disaster relief work. It's really important to have that kind of imagery up and accessible, and again, even to be able to put it up into OSM to then digitize areas in very high resolution using drone imagery is very good application.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.